April 20th, 2017, City of Flint Town Hall Meeting.
I guess all we can say, if the 47% rollback that you said was promised by Detroit Water and Sewer, would like to see information on that.
It's in writing.
Great. I've been working with Sue very closely over the last 6 months. I'll talk to her. Absolutely. Okay.
Here and once for Governor Snyder's advice. On the EPA end, hi, Mark.
around the country and around the world. That's in addition to, while this has been going on, Governor Snyder has given billions in tax cuts to corporations, billions in tax cuts to wealthy people. Why is it that Nestle right now is under consideration to drain the fresh water in Michigan? Why isn't that water coming here, home delivery?
Yep, so thanks for your question, Jordan. There were two sides to the analytical question that you asked. There was the biological side, and then there's the chemistry side, lead, total trihalomethanes, et cetera. So on the bacterial side, universities being funded through public health and National Science Foundation grants are collecting data. And I'll be honest with you, I don't know if their data is the same or different than the water defense data. I do know that we've gotten Scott connected with Wayne State on that. So that's that piece of it. Unfortunately, I can't comment on it because I'm just not as familiar. On the chemistry data, I can't speak to the Virginia Tech data directly. I can only speak to EPA's data. The state can certainly speak to their data.
Well, the EPA has funded Virginia Tech.
We did. I've seen Mark's summary numbers. I haven't looked as closely at his data as I've looked at our data. All right, and our experts like Miguel, who you know, and others have looked at it a lot closer. So with respect to the TTHM data, the lead data, the samples that were collected by comparable methods, all right, methods that are regulatorily compliant methods, our data and other third-party data, like Water Defense's data, look similar. We did side-by-side comparisons of that data, and we see that data look similar. And the numbers, even Scott's, using those methods, are below regulatory levels. The other sampling tool that he uses, he calls it the water bug. It's not a method that we can use to evaluate against regulatory methods. So unfortunately, even though that data is out there, it's not even the same units. We can't compare it to the regulations. It's our job as a regulator to collect samples in accordance with proper sampling methods and compare them to the regulatory levels to ensure safe delivery of water through the distribution system. Okay.
So there's no shower and bathing standards by the regulatory body, but people have burning eyes and other things in the shower. That's just, well, there's no standards. No,
I understand that point. And on that, you know, so that gets to a medical question. And that those are issues. And unfortunately, we've had a lot of discussion here about those medical issues that I think is a good placeholder for another discussion because we don't have our public health experts with us. But I get what you're saying. We are bound to the very stringent regulatory requirements that are designed to be protective of public health. So that's about as far as I can go.
You unilaterally say with the filters, it stops all bacteria.
So there's natural bacteria occurring in all water systems. Well, we know that. The question is, do these filters harbor bacteria, and is it harmful? And again, the studies that are being done right now, if something harmful is related to us, then it's something we will need to address, absolutely. So now I'll turn over to Mr. Baird.
I think this may be our last question.
So let me just try to address, I'm not directly involved. I only know pretty much what I've read in the papers, but I know that no decisions have been taken on the Nestle thing. DEQ is basically doing, and maybe George or Bryce have better insight than I do, but there are a variety of considerations before granting permission to extract the additional water that's being asked, and I know they're going through that process, and there is no predetermined answer to the best of my knowledge. Do you want to speak to it?
And that's exactly right, Rich. So there is a permit application before the DEQ, and before that could be granted, if it's granted, has to be assured that there's no adverse impact to the resources and, of course, that the water's safe to drink. And we are reviewing, at this time, 50,000 or so comments from people on that. So it's going to be some time before we get through all those comments, but it will not be issued unless it's determined there's no adverse impact on the resources. So.
Because we're really running tight on time, we want to get through everybody who's standing if we can. So can we
questions and then have short answers so that we can get through everybody's questions.
Hey, as long as I get an answer, I'm okay. Okay, quick question. Well, the KWA bond, I understand now Detroit somehow is paying that for us, correct? Mm-hmm. How did we get out of that so easy when we were told it was a bond?
Okay. No, that's a great question, and it wasn't easy. When we talked to Great Lakes Water about providing us long-term water supply, we knew that we would have the burden of that $7 million a year bond payment. Great Lakes Water has several customers that they serve in the area of Flint. Those customers right now do not have a backup supply. Great Lakes Water recognized that if they actually acquired the water rights that we had under the KWA, they could have that water under an emergency treated at the county plant and provided to their customers in the area. So they were willing to pay to stand behind Flint, their $7 million a year bond, to get that reliability for their other customers in the area, as well as they were able to avoid a couple construction projects by maintaining Flint as a customer.
How long she's going to live, and if she's going to find her dad dead. This is still a blast. Many of you up here know me. You know what I'm talking about. We still have the $10,000 in medical debt for Mike. But here's the issue we're still skipping. The pets. I know you folks think they're just dogs, they're just cats. I don't care what you think they just are. We just buried two more dogs. A friend of mine just buried her third dog. One more person says it's just one of those incidental coincidences. My head will explode. The pets are being ignored by everybody. Somebody's got to address this. Dogs, cats, hamsters, I don't care what it is. Turtles, tortoises.
Deer.
They're dying in droves. So it's bad enough the dog, it's bad enough the hospital, my husband. But then when you're putting down a 1.5-year-old puppy and you're informed her brain deformities were so huge because her mother was born lead poisoned. She was born lead poisoned. Can we get somebody to step this up? Anybody? Michigan State University. Somebody reach out to them, please.
We can do that. I think that's something that we have overlooked, Carrie. I'm glad you brought that to our attention, because they're not just pets, they're part of your family. Right. So we'll see if we can get somebody to address those issues as well. And let me just say, it wasn't easy, and some of it was not taking no for an answer. You know, we were told we couldn't go back to Detroit, and we did. So sometimes it's not taking no for an answer and standing up and continuing to fight and push. So that's what happened. But we will address that as well. Thank you.
Carrie, there's one other thing I'd just like to add, is that early on I was under the impression that part of the KWA deal, Flint had pledged as security its plant and water delivery system. Hang on, just let me finish. So, and I thought that that's why that deal simply could not be undone, and then I learned that that was not true, that that was a rumor that I didn't check out, and when I finally figured it out, it's not true. So that allowed us to go to GCDC and say, what would it take? And this, one of the reasons, we haven't talked about some of the components of this deal, but GCDC wants to build another pipeline. We were able to find a way to help them finance and provide a grant in the form of about $7.5 million so they could do that. So that was how we could get Flint's pipeline back, because the clock was ticking, and October 1st or thereabouts, KWA water was going to flow through Flint's pipeline. And we didn't know what we were going to do. And so this is one of the reasons, coupled with the fact that any switch is difficult, even if it's lake to lake. I mean, you know what the river did to us. So so to be able to avoid another water switch, to be able to keep Flint whole on the KWA situation, and to be able to save basically almost $100 million that we could use for things, you know, Flint, but when this is all said and done, that Flint will have, I think, a water system where the water will be real-time technology monitored all across the city. If it's so much as changes shade, that the sensors are going to figure it out. But that's going to take some time, and it's going to take those kinds of things for this mayor and this and the leaders of this city to get the kind of confidence back that, yeah, we know exactly what's going on, and you can too. So that's why this deal made a ton of sense. It saved us $58 million that we would have had to spend on the treatment plant in order to treat raw water.
Yeah, and Rich, one additional thing to emphasize here. You know, we did sell that 72-inch pipe to Genesee County several years ago for $3.9 million, and I think we all look back at that. That probably wasn't a very good idea. But we're getting that pipe back for nothing. We're getting it back for free. So that was also a negotiated part of the deal. One of the reasons this deal took so long, there's so many components in it, and we wanted to bring it to you all with the best possible result.
Bacteria exists. Again, I will pronounce it again. Stenotrophomonas maltophilia. Please look it up. It is in the water. It is water acquired. It's aquatic, and it's horrible. And just because they treat it, it never goes away. It never goes away. So if I get sick again with pneumonia, it can come back. somewhere and ask scientists to help me. I had to beg for my life. Now, all I'm asking is right now there's flushers on my street. You guys say, you know, you got to keep the chlorine level. I understand that, but then we have the TTHM problem. I've been through that too with Mike Glasgow, okay, and he was worried about our street to begin with. And I know that I'm not the only one that's came down with this. And you need to start talking. You need to start talking now.
So, ma'am, first of all, thank you. I'm very, very sorry for the pain that you went through. I truly am. And I just found out about your situation today, and I promise you I will get into it. I very much wish our public health people were here. I haven't been able to talk to them yet, but there's nobody should have to go through what you went through. I just need to understand exactly what's going on, and I promise you that there'll have to be answers that I can understand. And if I can understand them, and we need to do more things, then that's what we need to do. So that's you're Ms. Lane, right?
No, I'm Lisa Snow.
Okay.
But I live on Robbie Lane.
Robbie Lane. Okay, that's what I remembered was Robbie Lane. So what I would like to say is that, not being a scientist and not being a doctor, I have to learn, okay? And bacteria, I'm not afraid to talk about it. I know it's there. It's there in every water system, and I get that. But this one may be something totally different, and it must be. So I'm acknowledging the fact that it is an anomaly that needs to be investigated. Okay? Thank you. Well, I agree. It's just, not being a scientist, I don't know the answer.
And so, Ms. Stibbins, and when I say that we do need to listen to residents, we really do. In me talking to her, I did learn a lot about this. And so the unfortunate thing is that, as you know, Ms. Stibbins, and some of the others, is that it takes a while to get the test results and to compare the test results to the biological samples that we receive. So we are waiting for Wayne State to get not only that result, but also the result for the Legionella study that they're doing. So we are listening to residents from the city, and the young lady, I can't remember the name, Mayor, is it Tiana? Tiana, I do want you to know, you asked about the water availability for residents. So as a public health expert, I will be looking at all of this information. We are looking at all of this information. And if we feel that it is necessary that on September 1st, there are certain populations that still need to have access to bottled water, then that recommendation will definitely go forward from the city on behalf of this public health expert. But we are looking at the bacteria in the water. We're not afraid to talk about it. We're not afraid to interact with residents, and we're not afraid to listen to residents, and we are doing that. And you know that. I don't work. And I received a press release from Genesee County Health Department, and I did read that. And so, but we are continuing. I am in contact with Wayne State. That's who we are talking to, who is looking at the water. I know that
Right,
the FATCHUP team. Yes, yes, yes. Right, and we will continue to do that. And be in contact.
Millions total, there is a portion that says it will allow more than $20 million in debt incurred by Flint for earlier water infrastructure repairs to be forgiven. I say my comment, I'm going to read a poem. It's called Harlem by Langston Hughes. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat, or crust and sugar over like syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load, or does it explode? Now, I wanted to say that because I've had like questions that I've been waiting an hour, but I could not like center myself to ask my questions just because of some things that have happened in this space. And I've been a facilitator for like over 10 years, and I know how to create a welcoming space, and you did not do that tonight. Because when I come to a community meeting, I look at norms, and right now you're norming having police in just like in full regalia with like bulletproof vests, and for me, I'm like, well, I feel like you want stuff to be escalating, because when I think of police, well, I have some things that I think of police, but when you have police specifically like in spaces that's supposed to be community spaces, that means that you're kind of pitting community people against the police, and why are the police here in these spaces where we are trying to share our pain? Because it feels like you want to punish people for sharing their pain, and there were three people who got hauled off to jail out there. Four. So, and actions have consequences, and as you are shutting people off and having police follow them, like, you're creating situations where you want escalation. Like, having police in spaces that people are in pain, you create escalation. Now, I've worked at de-escalating situations, but I feel like, you know, I've gone to contentious community meetings in white spaces and white communities, and they're not police in full on like gear. So I'm like, well, since we're in a majority black city, like, is that okay? Are we trying to norm this as this is going to be the norm? Anytime that there are community spaces, there need to be police there, because there's an implicit bias that black people are gonna get violent, so you're gonna have to haul them off to jail. And I had an employee that asked the question and was like kicked out like earlier before this space. And for me, I'm like, as we're sitting here trying to be perfunctory, people are getting shut off right now, and police are following the workers to shut people off. And you're going to have situations like what, as Melissa said, people undocumented and all this stuff. And you're gonna have some situations, there's probably gonna be a shootout, and not trying to be funny, but it's like, as people were being kicked out of this space because they were wearing hats, like, we got people, like, they're gonna get shot because of this water, because they're in pain, and I mean, nobody should be paying for this water until it's safe out of our pipes of filter. And the fact that, you know, this is gonna be creating spaces where you're gonna have explosions. And I do not wanna have explosions, but I'm saying, like, I lived in Flint for a while, and I'm ashamed to be from Flint, knowing that this is what Flint is looking like, where you're having police just out here. And I mean, it's implicit intimidation. Like, I'm triggered being in this space where I'm being surrounded by police, because there's this expectation that I've done something wrong, and I'm just here to exercise my First Amendment rights. And as a person who lives in Flint and pays for water, wanting to know what's the future of my community and how do we chart ourselves to our destiny collectively.
But we showering in the water, rashes. I have real bad allergies, so skin color changes that's happening. It's a nightmare. Then for my grandchildren, to watch them get boils, watch their hair fall out, you know, watch the eczema flare up 10 times worse, especially in the summer. My mom, you know, 67 years old, and she already, you know, getting older, having health issues, carrying cases of water, you know. She only has me here and my daughter, you know, and small grandchildren. We try. You know, I get tired too. My back hurts too. I had a car accident in 2010 with a back injury. So me trying to lift cases of water like that, it takes a toll on you. Secondly, we have the highest water rates, thank you, in the country. And you guys are saying to our, we the people, citizen of Flint, pay your water bills. You know, nobody want to be without water. We need to flush our toilets. Yeah, I was on that brigade. I didn't pay my water. My bill was $3,000. They turned it off. And I worked still diligently off of cases of water just to keep the toilet flush. Now, would I advise that to women and children to stand up, don't pay your water bill, let your water get cut off? Are you ready for the labor? Because it's hard. I tried it. Before I tell somebody else to do it, I'm going to walk the walk. Because that's what a leader will do. They don't drag people into the army and not tell you what the consequences are. But there is one person who can change this, who can lower our water rates, who can make it affordable. Mayor Weaver. This lady across the way that just spoke said, we elected you to stand with us, to fight. And we're asking you, we're not begging. We're not gonna beg no elected official that didn't even show up to this meeting. Shame on them. Thank you, Eric Mays, for being here, Carrie Nelson. Thank you, God. Election time, you're going to see more people in the street than anybody ever seen, because we're looking for solutions. We look at the panel, and it's just a panel. Don't nobody believe you guys. You're talking, but look at the crowd. They didn't dwindle off. You really didn't reach the population you need to really talk to. They didn't even show up. And that's pretty much our population is in Flint. Two, we have one person that can lower our water rates. Mayor Weaver. Will you stand with the citizen Flint? We the people. We don't have the tax, the little credits they gave us no more. The water gonna stop in September. We already know that. We want to be proactive, right? That's what they say, be proactive. We got the highest unemployment rate. There's no jobs in Flint. Thank you goodness we had a water pile jobs where we gave a few people jobs. But what's that going on with? We still got the highest water rates, no jobs, and we're going to have to start buying cases of water again. So, Mayor Weaver, will you lower the water rates in the city of Flint?
I'm going to say something as soon as we get this last comment. I have something to say.
The
there are multiple programs that are, do not, they last until 2018. We are continuing, we will continue to look at, there's programs that we do have in place that we are hoping that will improve the trajectory of our children, including nutrition programs. We also have the RECAST program, which is looking at putting activities in place for youth in the summer, but keeping them active. But we do have work that we have to do, and I agree. We do have to continue to watch and monitor. We're not finished here. That is why I am here, to be able to listen to residents and continue to monitor what is going on as a result of this crisis. I don't disagree with you. A lot of the questions that have been asked, I agree with. They're valid points. We are noting the points, and we are continuing to monitor this. But that's all I can say right now. But I am acting on the information that I am receiving. I do want you to know that, and we do look to independent researchers to validate our concerns and to ask them, how do we move forward using the best and moving forward in the best way for the health and well-being of families as a whole, the children and our elderly. Mayor Weaver, I'll just say this one piece, and then I know you want to finish. But 6 months ago when I got here, one of the programs that was here was the RECAST program. And it is not the be-all, the end-all, but it is a start for us to begin looking at what activities that we can put in place as a result of this trauma, this man-made trauma. We are looking at how do we put a stop to anything moving forward that is going to hinder and to help to better, again, to better the trajectory of our youth. But that is one of the programs that are in place. Again, there are a few others, but no, we don't have all of the answers today.
Medicaid enrollment started in 2016. It goes for the next 5 years, so it's until age 2021. You asked about services for in the schools. We have family supports coordination, again, that's through March of 2021. We also have the Child and Adolescent Health Center that is expanded into many of the schools through September 2018. So we have a lot of services that are in place, but with the family supports coordination, any services that the child may need, any special ed, anything that they may need as a result of being affected by the lead is available for them free of charge. So all you have to do have been affected by April 2014, 0 to 21, and you're eligible. And basically for the next the enrollment period right now is through March of 2021. But these children could be eligible until they're age 21. So if they're, you know, newborns, for the next 2 decades.
Okay, I understand what you're saying, but being someone that has raised their children off of Medicaid being someone that has raised some of their children off of Medicaid, I know Medicaid is not a good program, especially with what we're dealing with right
one-on-one so they can ask her questions. Would that be okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Good evening to each and every one of you on the panel this evening. I have a question and statement from Mayor Weaver, and then for the prospective members on to her side, a question for you all. Mayor Weaver, I met you, me and my fiance, when you were getting running for office, and you explained some things to me about your platform that you were running on. I knew that things would be challenging for you the months to come once you were elected. I want to say to you, there seems to be, and I've called the water department, spoke with the department heads there. I've even walked across the hall and spoke with your secretary, a young lady that works with you. You're busy, I understand that. There seems to be an allocation of funds for certain residents in the city of Flint that is not being spoken of or spoken for, and that is the deceased residents. There's a credit for water for residents. And forgive me, Pastor Stewart, given honor to you, sir, pastor of this house, and it's always a good time, always good to see you. Pastor Stewart, as we all know, is a mortician. Pastor Stewart knows how many people have died in the city of Flint. At a minimum, during this process, there's been 10,000 residents that have died. I'm not saying a cause of death. I'm speaking on the issue of their credit for their water bill. Nobody seems to know where the allocation of these funds are going to. Is it going back to their families? Is it put in an estate? Is it in front of Judge Fullerton in probate? Where is this money at? Because when you do the math, at a minimum of 10,000 residents over a three-year period, and that's just the minimum. We know there's more residents that have died. Flint Journal shows that. Channel 12, Channel 25, they put those obituaries up. At a minimum of $600 times 10,000. That's just at that 10,000. Where are those deceased credit funds at? Second, Mayor Weaver, you promised us transparency within the departments of City Hall. Isn't it true that the city council members that are not here today were not notified of this town hall meeting?
No.
48 hours?
No. I've been, no.
Okay.
No, I started talking about this over a week ago.
We'll let that go. We'll let that go. You answered that question. Moving to the third. So the young lady and the gentleman here, out of each of your departments, have you decided to give a letter to Mayor Weaver stating, due to the investigatorial process of this that's happening with the city of Flint and its water issues, it would be best that the residents not pay a full percentage of their water bill? I believe if you all send a correspondence to the mayor's office requesting that these residents not pay this full amount for their water, it would make you not only look better, but it would be a better position for this business decision that's being implemented upon the residents. I'm going to let that linger a little bit with you. Maybe you can't send a correspondence to the mayor. I don't know if you should be. And before I go, Mayor Weaver, in closing, have you been in touch with President Trump's administration as to the issues pertaining to the city of Flint as you were with President Obama? Thank you.
Okay. You know, I had some other questions I wanted to address, too. That's going to be in the end. I have reached out to the new administration. I did have a meeting with him. It was a very brief meeting. I told him that I wanted to have a sit down and talk with him about what was going on in Flint. I said that one of the things you said to us was infrastructure was a priority. That's a priority that we have here in the city of Flint, so that's something we have in common. And I would love to have the opportunity to sit down and have a conversation with you about where we've come from, where we are right now, and the direction we want to go. He said he would too. I did have my chief of staff follow up and try to get a meeting set up. We have had a conference call, but I have not had an opportunity to have the same kind of sit-down talk with him. But I also want to address something because you talked about the water credits. And I remember having that conversation and asking for those to be extended. But one thing I need to say is I'm not the only person that needs to be asking for that. Just like we've had a Michigan delegation with our state, with our senators and our congressmen going to Congress, we have people, we have a Lansing delegation, and they should have been going and asking those, having that conversation as well. We have state representatives, we have a state senator, and we need to press upon them the importance of being strong and helping us take our message forward. When I went and sat down and had that conversation, I was by myself. I had my CFO with me, but I didn't have a Lansing delegation go with me and say, we're supporting you and trying to get this. And so we need to be mindful about that as well, that it can't, you know, I can't do it all by myself. And so that's why they're there, and that was why we elected them, so we could form a strong team to go and ask for these things and make demands. And so we have to put some of it there as well. And so we have to ask them to be part of helping us push our agenda forward. Okay, well, I'll let him answer. Oh, you had the question about the people that have died and where
yes,
those
ma'am.
Credits have gone.
With respect to the deceased resident.
Okay. The ratepayers in the city of Flint have received over $40 million in water credits. Those credits, when they are assigned to the account, the water rate account. And those credits stay with the account, not with the person. There is one caveat to that, and that is with a renter who has signed a form that says that they will pay the water bill. With that, if a renter has left, they can apply at Treasury or online to receive their water credits if they had earned them and have not used them. And that is a process where it's first come, first serve, and we are working through that list. So the credits stay with the account, which is a tie, which is basically tied to an address. That's how that works.
But in the form of, you know, getting to that, and hearing this from Judge Fullerton, who's over probate, that's an estate matter. That becomes the property of that individual's estate. And the family members, whoever is going to be the executive of that estate, have the right to apply on behalf of that deceased individual for those funds.
Well, the credits go towards the account, and if the estate
because
has...
Because an account is assessed a social security number, and it takes credit to get your water on and all that.
It goes to the account, and then the estate will handle the property and the assets with that account. That's how that would work. I'm not an attorney, but...
That's correct.
Okay, so the credits go to the account.
Has your department... Now, I want to move on. Has your department been in touch with probate court as to any numerical numbers that you may have within your department of deceased individuals with alleged of credits been forwarded to probate for to be investigated and looked into?
That matter hasn't come to my attention.
It has now.
Has not come to my attention until today.
It has now. And as a resident and citizen of this community, I am asking you, employing you, to gather that information and send it over to probate so it may be looked into. This is not something for Mayor Weaver. This is for your department.
Again, the credits belong to the account, and the account belongs to the home, and the home belongs to the estate, and the estate representative will handle that.
And understand.
Okay, very good.
You are in front of a Governor Snyder's appointee, and he's listening very well. And I do believe the gentleman is going to be asking you a question. This needs to be looked into because that money is not to just float out there because you say an account. It takes a social security number to set up an account. You're an adult, I'm an adult, we know that. Those monies are not just free monies to be lingered within the city of Flint and done with and allocated for whatever they're to be allocated for. No, it goes to that family in the form of an estate.
I did not say
that. Thank you so much.
I did not say that. Those apply to the account.
Being
answer the gentleman's question regarding the process for shutting off. Basically, what happens is we go through and we look at the large dollar accounts that are due and owing. We then post those homes and we give those people 10 days minimum to come in and pay their bills. Also, when we knock on the door, we bring with us the nonprofit organizations to come in and help if help is needed. And we work that way, and we do our best to give everyone the opportunity to come in and pay and get notice so that they can make their payment.
Listen, you know what? I have to. Let me say something.
This is the April 20th, 2017 City of Flint Town Hall Meeting.
Isn't your dad supposed to be here? He's coming. He promised. I trust him.
Show time, guys. 1 minute.
April 20th, 2017, City of Flint Town Hall Meeting.
2,000 residents that have died. I'm not saying a cause of death. I'm speaking on the issue of their credit for their water bill. Nobody seems to know where the allocation of these funds are going to. Is it going back to their families? Is it put in an estate? Is it in front of Judge Fullerton in probate? Where is this money at? Because when you do the math, at a minimum of 10,000 residents over a 3-year period, and that's just the minimum. We know there's more residents that have died. Flint Journal shows that. Channel 12, Channel 25, they put those obituaries up. At a minimum of $600 times 10,000. That's just at that 10,000. Where are those deceased credit funds at? Second, Mayor Weaver, you promised us transparency within the departments of City Hall. Isn't it true that the City Council members that are not here today were not notified of this Town Hall meeting?
No.
48 hours?
No. No.
Okay.
No, I started talking about this over a week ago.
We'll let that go.
We'll
let that go. You answered that question. Moving to the third. So, the young lady and the gentleman here, out of each of your departments, Have you decided to give a letter to Mayor Weaver stating, due to the investigatorial process of this that's happening with the city of Flint and its water issues, it would be best that the residents not pay a full percentage of their water bill? I believe if you all send a correspondence to the mayor's office requesting that these residents not pay this full amount for their water, it would make you not only look better, but it would be a better position for this business decision that's being implemented upon the residents. I'm going to let that linger a little bit with you. Maybe you can't send a correspondence to the mayor. I don't know if you should be. And before I go, Mayor Weaver, in closing, have you been in touch with President Trump's administration as to the issues pertaining to the city of Flint as you were with President Obama? Thank you.
Okay. You know, I had some other questions I wanted to address, too. That's going to be in the end. I have reached out to the new administration. I did have a meeting with him. It was a very brief meeting. I told him that I wanted to have a sit down and talk with him about what was going on in Flint. I said that one of the things you said to us was infrastructure was a priority. That's a priority that we have here in the city of Flint, so that's something we have in common. And I would love to have the opportunity to sit down and have a conversation with you about where we've come from, where we are right now, and the direction we want to go. He said he would too. I did have my chief of staff follow up and try to get a meeting set up. We have had a conference call, but I have not had an opportunity to have the same kind of sit-down talk with him. But I also want to address something because you talked about the water credits. And I remember having that conversation and asking for those to be extended. But one thing I need to say is, I'm not the only person that needs to be asking for that. Just like we've had a Michigan delegation with our state, with our senators and our congressmen going to Congress, we have people, we have a Lansing delegation, and they should have been going and asking those, having that conversation as well. We have state representatives, we have a state senator, and we need to press upon them the importance of being strong and helping us take our message forward. When I went and sat down and had that conversation, I was by myself. I had my CFO with me, but I didn't have a Lansing delegation go with me and say, we're supporting you and trying to get this. And so we need to be mindful about that as well, that it can't, you know, I can't do it all by myself. And so that's why they're there, and that was why we elected them, so we could form a strong team to go and ask for these things and make demands. And so we have to put some of it there as well. And so we have to ask them to be part of helping us push our agenda forward. Okay, well, I'll let him answer. Oh, you had the question about the people that have died and where
yes,
those credits have gone.
To the
okay.
Resident.
Okay. The ratepayers in the city of Flint have received over $40 million in water credits. Those credits, when they are assigned to the account, the water rate account. And those credits stay with the account, not with the person. There is one caveat to that, and that is with a renter who has signed a form that says that they will pay the water bill. With that, if a renter has left, they can apply at Treasury or online to receive their water credits if they had earned them and have not used them. And that is a process where it's first come, first serve, and we are working through that list. So the credits stay with the account, which is basically tied to an address. That's how that works.
But in the form of, you know, getting to that, and hearing this from Judge Fullerton, who's over probate, that's an estate matter. That becomes the property of that individual's estate. And the family members, whoever is going to be the executive of that estate, have the right to apply on behalf of that deceased individual for those funds.
Well, the credits go towards the account, and if the estate
because
has...
Because an account is assessed a Social Security number, and it takes credit to get your water on and all that.
It goes to the account, and then the estate will handle the property and the assets with that account. That's how that would work. I'm not an attorney, but
that's correct.
Okay, so the credits go to the account.
Has your department, now I want to move on, has your department been in touch with probate court as to any numerical numbers that you may have within your department of deceased individuals with allegement of credits been forwarded to probate for to be investigated and looked into?
That matter hasn't come to my attention.
It has now.
Has not come to my attention until today.
It has now. And as a resident and citizen of this community, I am asking you, employing you, to gather that information and send it over to probate so it may be looked into. This is not something for Mayor Weaver. This is for your department.
Again, the credits belong to the account, and the account belongs to the home, and the home belongs to the estate, and the estate representative will handle that.
And understand.
Okay, very good.
You are in front of a Governor Snyder's appointee, and he's listening very well. And I do believe the gentleman is going to be asking you a question. This needs to be looked into, because that money is not to just float out there because you say an account. It takes a Social Security number to set up an account. You're an adult, I'm an adult, we know that. Those monies are not just free monies to be lingered within the city of Flint and done with and allocated for whatever they're to be allocated for. No, it goes to that family in the form of an estate.
I did not say
that. Thank you so much.
I did not say that. Those apply to the account. To answer the gentleman's question regarding the process for shutting off, basically what happens is we go through and we look at the large dollar accounts that are due and owing. We then post those homes and we give those people 10 days minimum to come in and pay their bills. Also, when we knock on the door, we bring with us the nonprofit organizations to come in and help if help is needed. And we work that way, and we do our best to give everyone the opportunity to come in and pay and get notice so that they can make their payment.
Listen, you know what? I have to let me say something. I do agree with you on some of that. I really do, because we have to work on customer service, especially when we're going through what we're going through, and that's something that we have been talking about and looking at. And we've been having that conversation, and I'm really hoping that's going to be getting better, because we've been looking at that, because I have felt the same way, because we're in a terrible situation right now. and to have to deal with certain kinds of things when we know we're asking people to pay for the water. There's a way you do it. There's a way you do it, and it's just that simple. And the other thing I want to say is I want to talk. I don't know where True went. Maybe she's gone, but she was talking about some. Okay. Well, you can tell her if she's not in here because I don't see her. When we were talking about some of the mental health concerns, some of the things, she's right, some of the things we're not going to be able to do something about. Some of it, we know there's some money that's been set aside long term for the kids. But that was one of the issues we talked about, is we have kids that are going to be having behavioral problems, special education problems, juvenile justice problems, and that's why it was so important that we do educate not only teachers but parents on what to look out for their children and when they notice some changes. I'm hoping everybody is going to take full advantage of what we have. We've said it's not enough. We've said we want more, and we're going to continue to say that, but it's real important that people are educated on what to look out for, and that's what we have to do. We've talked about needing more school nurses in the schools. We've gotten that. We've talked about needing more mental health services in the schools, and that's something that was an issue before the water crisis, and it's more of an issue at this point. And so that's something that we have to work with the school district on, really, because that is a separate entity. But we know we need more mental health services because we know these kids are going to need more supports, and when your kids have issues, you have issues. And so we've got to, that's something that we've got to continue to address. So she's absolutely right. But right now we have to, you know, with what we have, we've got to continue to educate people and let them know what to look for, and early identification is going to be the best thing. So when people go in for these services, they get all of those other screenings, and that's what we want them to have. So we'll know what other services we need to put in place and what other kinds of support. So we are still working on that, and we can't fix all of that at one time. We were talking about water. You know, I'm just going to tell you, I'm between a rock and a hard place. Because one thing is, I mean, we're doing the water rate study, because that was the question that I asked is, can we lower the rates? On the other hand, while I like you, Rich, you know, we've wanted the state out, but the other thing is, I'm in between a rock and a hard place. We need some money to come in. I don't have any money to run this city, and when we, you know, we've got to look at this is a bad thing and this is a bad thing. So how are we going to make the best of a bad hand? You know, we've got to play the hand we've been dealt, and so that's why I have asked people to pay for the water bills. I sure have. I'm paying that high rate too. I don't like it. It was something I complained about before, and I'm going to keep complaining about it. And that was why I asked for the water study rate. That's what we're looking at. Like I said, I need help from other people too. So it's not that I don't want to do certain things, but to run the city, I've got to have some money. I've got to have some money. I want us to stay autonomous. I want us to govern ourselves. I don't want to have an emergency manager come back in, but I can't do it if I don't have any money. And when, you know, as we lose population, that's just what I was getting ready to say, and as people leave the city, we don't have that tax base. And so that's why we've got to fix these other things, because people will continue to leave if we don't address these issues. And that's why I want people to see that we are trying to fix Flint. Nope, I didn't create it, but I'm trying to deal with it the best I can. And one of the things I need people to do is to come together. I said, you know, when we all got in the room and tried to work this deal out, we were blaming each other and finger pointing, and it didn't get us very far. And so while we may not be happy with everything we have, you know, that's where I am. So that's what I'm asking for. There was something else I wanted to say. You know, this shows the importance of us having this town hall meeting, because people have a lot to say, we have a lot to hear, and we said we weren't going to do anything until we heard from people. And so we're going to continue to have these things. We weren't going to make these decisions. I'm not dismissing anybody's pain, because we see that we're all in pain and we've all had to deal with it, and it's been very, very difficult. One thing I'm never going to say I'm ashamed to be from Flint. I'm proud to be from Flint. I was born and raised here. I think I'm strong. I think we are strong, and I think we're stronger when we're working together and supporting one another. And I'm not ashamed to be from Flint at all. I want to show people that we're going to come back from this, we're going to rebound from this, and we're going to be on the map for something different than a water crisis. We're going to show them how we took this bad situation and made something great happen. And I have been fighting, and I'm not scared to keep fighting. And that's how we've been able to get some of these things. Like I said, when they told us that we couldn't go back to Detroit water, I said, I believe we can. And right before the election, wow, we went back to Detroit water. When we said we couldn't get out of KWA, I said, I bet we can. And we did. So we need to stop taking no for an answer, and we need to come together and try to make these things happen. And that's what I'm asking for your support for, to help me do these things and to move us forward. So I don't know if we have any more questions, but I thank you for this, and I want you to come. I keep telling you, you better come to the office and help. That's what I want you to do. I want you all to come and help. Yes. I didn't want to lower it. I said, I'm looking at a water study rate, because that was the question I've been asking. I was the one that said our rates were raised illegally. I haven't forgotten that. That's why I'm asking to look at this. That's the exact reason. That's why I want this recommendation to move forward. And it's real hard to do things when I'm not pointing any fingers at somebody, but when I got Councilman Mays is the only person that seems to be fighting and working with me to move some things forward, it is difficult. Thank you, Councilman. Right, I know it. I'm trying. And you know what else you said? There's something else you said that some of the people aren't here that need to hear this. I want you to go out and tell them. I want you all to go out and tell them what you learned today. I hope this was very helpful. I'm sorry that police were here, but we've had on the flip side of this, we've had some people say things got out of hand and they didn't want to come if we didn't have police. I mean, it's hard to know what to do. And so that's what some people have said. Now, there's two sides to every story. And so, you know, so that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. Wait just a minute. I can't hear. I know it. And that's the exact reason that I've been asking for this. And that's why we are having the water rate study. And it's something that's going to... I know it. You're absolutely right. I'm not denying that. And that was why I was asking for this. So it's going to take us a couple of months. And then we shall have some information. But, excuse me. With that, I think, Pastor Stewart, am I calling you up here?
Yes. I just want to tell the people to understand that we have a problem in the city of Flint. It's just not only about the water. It's about the people in the city of Flint. It's not standing up and being counted for. We got a young man who was born and raised here, worked with Governor Snyder side by side. He's a Flint resident. He's my homeboy. And I'm here to tell him today. I told him once before, he told the people of the city of Flint once before, whatever we needed, all you got to do is ask for it. And I'm telling y'all right now, again, in front of him today, I'm telling you to take back this 3 years of expansion that Governor Snyder put on the city of Flint for the people to hold back and get their water taken care of. That's not the problem. That's not going to solve the problem. We need to get this problem done today. We need to get... The 3 years that we're waiting for to expand this water, I'm asking you from me to take it back to your governor to tell him I need this water crisis done in 1 year. Because if we don't get it done now, if we're starting to leave out our office, the people that are suffering now about this, all this issue, bacteria issue, going to have a problem once starting to get out the house. And I'm not going to allow the people to have this resident to come back after Snyder's gone to deal with this problem all over again. Tyler, you telling the people what we cannot do. This is the people city. This is your mayor. You guys put her in there. If you won't think, you guys got to learn how to stand up and be counted for. Quit bullshitting around with everybody around you telling you what you can't not do and what you can do. It's time now to the people of the city to stand forward and be counted for the action in this city. We need to stand up and tell the Governor Snyder what we want, not what he want to give us, when he want to give us to us. It's time for us to get what we need done now. Why should I allow my people to suffer for the next 3 years and we can get this matter done in 1 year? You got the funds, let's put it to work, put the people to work, and let's get this problem done. And you talk city councilmen not doing their job. You see what they're doing. They're not here supporting you when it comes to a matter. We need to walk and march and talk about what's going on in the city. We need to talk about what we're going to do. We need other people. We need to stand up and start praying about our matter to get this situation done, because God said we bring all things to him, not to man or woman. We don't take it to our Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. What can we accomplish today? Nothing. You see the creation of the problems that created today. Everybody got a stir to cry out about. We're crying about what's going on in the city, but what are we doing about it? We talking about it. We ain't doing nothing about it. Every time the mayor walks down, go down to Washington, Lansing, and fight for us, what do? We sit at home flicking the TV. We should be standing in front of Washington, Lansing, standing right behind and telling what we want, not what they want to give us. As long as we stand behind these walls and talk about it and not being about it, we don't get nothing done. This man been here several times crying out, listening to what y'all talking about and what y'all doing. How he's going to help us if we can't get along with him?
Thank you. Like I said, I hope this was informative. I hope you got some of your questions and your concerns answered. I'm gonna get with you. Let me thank everybody for coming. I hope that you got some information that was helpful. I hope you got some of your questions and concerns addressed. I hope you will take this information out to the people. I hope you all will stand with me, and as we continue to go and push forward, I told you I'm not tired. I got a sore foot, but I'm not tired. And we're going to keep moving forward. And I appreciate you coming. We're going to have some more town halls. But I do believe I have to call Pastor Stewart up here. I think he has something that he wants to say, is what I was told. Pastor?
All right. Now, I just want to just address everybody that's remaining here in the room. You know, I've been pretty much sitting through all of this, and basically what has transpired here tonight ain't really solved nothing. You know, back and forth, that don't, it really wouldn't have mattered whether we'd have had the meeting at in the church or in the woods. It still would have been the same. I just want to try to be a mediator if I can, because as far as being on anybody's side, I'm on the Lord's side. From what I have gathered during this whole crisis is that basically the people don't have any trust in the federal government, the state government, and now pretty much the city government. So what needs to happen, what I really would hope that would happen, is that the city government do whatever is in your power. I don't know what you can do, but you know what you can do. Do what you can do, do what you do have control over, because the people that's living here in the Flint, in the city of Flint, is the one that's actually living it. They're the ones suffering through all of it. And they're having to endure all of these issues that has been mentioned the people here pretty much are the ones that's suffering through it. They're living it. Now, this particular church here is in the city of Flint, and we can't use the water for drinking or cooking or anything of that nature. We have to bring water in for people to drink and to cook and prepare food for it. So we are actually experiencing it as well, and we're just trying to do whatever we can to survive without complaining. The Bible says do all things without murmuring and disputing. Because even when you do your little frustrations and, you're acting out, that ain't going to help nothing either. Because at the end of the day, you're still going to be dealing with whatever the problem you have. So, we have to do things decently and in order. And I'm praying that the citizens of Flint will be the recipients of some relief. And so I'm praying that something will transpire, that, the officials will gain the trust of the people back again. Because until that happens, you're going to have, it's just going to get worse and worse. And so we just need to stay prayerful. Everybody needs to stay prayerful. Because God is really the only one that can fix it. And the way he fixes it through people. And so, I just want to encourage all of you to just try to, just try to hang in there. I know it's bad. You're suffering through a lot of different ordeals, and I sympathize with you. But just hang in there. I just believe that, relief is going to eventually come. That help is going to eventually come. Just try to hang in there, Don't throw in the towel yet. I'm a Southern boy. I came up here from Arkansas. But Flint has been good to me. And I wouldn't take nothing for Flint. And so I'm just, grateful to the Lord just, to be able to open the doors for you all can come in, But whatever you do, just respect each other, Respect each other, because, when you have your fallouts and all of that, it ain't going to solve nothing. You're just going to add to whatever the problem, that you're already experiencing. So,